Morning.
Morning.
How's everyone doing?
Good.
Whew. Well, I've had one of those mornings. Have you ever had one of those mornings? My little holder thing is one of the things. But God is still good, amen? Even if we have a morning, so pray for me. If I go off or fall asleep, it's because I've had one of those mornings and nights. But anyways, God is still good. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Daniel chapter 11, verse 33. Daniel chapter 11, verse 33. The title of today's message is The Man of Sin, Part 3. The Man of Sin, Part 3. And I have a joke. I'll see if I can tell this joke. There were three people hanging on a rope that were saved from a helicopter from drowning out of a flood. There were 10 men and one woman. They all decided that one person should get off because if they didn't, the rope would break and everyone would die. No one could decide who should jump off or let go of the rope. Finally, a woman gave a really touching speech on how she would give up her life to save the others. Because women are used to giving up things for their husbands, their children, and giving in to men anyway. All the men started clapping. That was pretty good. There you go. Yeah. There you go. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much. And I ask that, Father, as your word says, that when we are weak, you are strong. And Father, I feel a little weak today, and I just ask that you would strengthen me. I thank you that your word is never weak, and you are never weak. But I ask that, Lord, you would speak through me, Lord. Speak through your word, but anoint my tongue, that, Father, I would say nothing less and nothing more than you once said, Father. I pray that your word would quicken us, that it wouldn't be just more information, but it would really be transformation. It would transform us, and that we would become the men and women of God you want us to be. Lord, it's not enough just to hear it, but we need to be effectual doers. So God, please change us. Change us. Minister to us. And I pray that everyone here would leave touched by you. I ask, Father, for rhema words. I pray that, Father, as I speak, you would speak through the words and you would touch hearts and you would quicken minds and you would draw. If there's anyone here that's not saved, that they would get saved today. If there's anyone on the fence playing games with you and not really living for you, they would really give their life fully to you. I pray that your word would accomplish all that you have set it forth to do. We love you. And we ask for this in the mighty, most powerful name of all, the name of Jesus. And everyone agreed, said,
Amen.
Amen. Verse 33 of Daniel chapter 11. And those of the people who understand shall instruct many. Yet for many days they shall fall by the sword. Need to start time. And those the people who understand shall instruct many. Yet for many days they shall fall by the sword and flame by captivity and plundering. Verse 34, now when they fall, they shall be aided with little help, but many shall join with them by intrigue. Verse 35, and some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them, purify them, and make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for appointed time. This, if you haven't been here, if you're a visitor or haven't been here a while, this is going to kind of just be all new to you. But as I've said before, all of our teachings are online. So if you didn't get the teaching last week or the week before, or maybe you're one of those people that comes once a month, then you can listen online because you need to, because if you don't, you won't kind of understand this. But I'm going to kind of give you a little overview. Verses 2 through 34 in chapter 11 are chronicling 470 years of Jewish history. How many? That's a long time. So it's saying from verse 2 to verse 34 is 470 years of Jewish history. But suddenly, verse 35 leapfrogs over centuries. And why? Because verse 32 speaks of Daniel's 69 weeks. Does everyone remember Daniel's 69 weeks? How many raise your hand out there? Remember that? For those of you who don't know, there was a total of 70 weeks of Daniel, and they were 70 sets of 7 years, which is what? 490 years. Okay, and then we still have 1 week left, but we've gone through 469 weeks. 69 times 7 years is what? 483 years. And that started when? That started when King Artaxerxes commissioned the Israelites to rebuild the temple. So from that date to, I forget the date, 445 BC, I think that's it. Is that right? I don't know when it was. But it's from that date, whatever that date was, to the Lord's triumphal entry was 483 years. And that is the 69 weeks. But hear this for overview. When Jesus came to his own, the triumphal entry, and they rejected him, the week stopped. So that 483 years stopped right when Jesus was rejected by the Jews. Now we're in the time of, does anyone know what time this is? We're in the church age, or the age of grace. And how many know we got one more week left, one more seven-year period? Does anyone know what that period is? Anyone know? Tribulation period. How many do not want to be there for the tribulation? Amen. Okay, good. We're all good on that. So then now Daniel's going to speak in verse 35. He speaks of Daniel's 70th week, which is still to come. In between verses 34 and 35, as I said, is the church age. And when the church age is over is when we are raptured. Amen? Rapture. How many looking forward to the rapture? Today I was crying out for the rapture. Anyone cry out for the rapture lately? I'm crying out. I said, Lord, revival or rapture? Because I am tired of this world. Amen? Can you say amen to that? I'm tired of it. I'm tired of the insanity of this crazy world. So revival or rapture, that should be our bumper sticker. But Daniel's 70 week, the time of the tribulation starts right when we are raptured. That's when it starts. That's why Daniel jumps from Antiochus Epiphanes. Do you remember what Antiochus Epiphanes is? He's from the Seleucid family up in Syria. And that was the four, remember there's two generals, there's four generals that broke off from Alexander the Great. And then there was two of them. There was the Seleucid family that was in the north, Syria. And then there was the Ptolemy family that was in Egypt in the south. And the reason we know those two is because they were warring between Israel and always fighting for Israel. So out of the Syrians, which is funny, we have a lot of issues with Syrians right now, but you know, still around. But the Syrians, is Antiochus Epiphanes came out of it, and he was what? He was a picture or a foreshadow of the Antichrist. Amen? And why was that? Does anyone remember why that was? This is like history. Here it is. Because why? He set up the abomination of desolation. He went into the temple, sacrificed a pig on the altar, made the priest drink the blood, and basically defiled the temple. How many know in the tribulation, the Antichrist is going to do the same thing? Amen? But instead of pig's blood, he's going to say, I'm God. Worship me. And that'll be in 3.5 years in the tribulation. He'll look like a great, loving, peace-loving guy, bringing everyone together. And then finally, the abomination of desolation, which has already been a picture, has been kind of pictured through Antiochus Epiphanes. Now the Antichrist will actually come in and say, worship me as God. If you don't, then you'll die. And how many, as I said, do not want to be here for that? How many want their loved ones not to be here for that? And you're going to see why that's so important today. And you're going to see why it's important. Then Daniel jumps, as I said, to Antiochus Epiphanes, to the end times. Yet Antiochus Epiphanes was part, as I said, the first 69 weeks, the 483 years. Now we're going to go to the last week, the seventh seven-year tribulation, where someone even more vile than, as I said, than Antiochus Epiphanes, the Antichrist, is going to come on the scene. Verse 36, then the king shall do according to his own will. Just like Lucifer, who said what? I will make myself like the Most High. How many know that? Isaiah 14:14. He said, I will make myself. Now think about this. People always say, you know, I was talking with someone, how many have heard of Calvinism, Arminianism? Right? An extreme Calvinist will say, God, if man has free will, then God isn't sovereign. And then Arminius will say, if we have free will, then God is not sovereign. So you have this argument. But how many know this? If you go extreme with extreme Calvinism, then guess who made Satan sin? God. That's scary, isn't it? Because Jesus said he was a liar or a murderer from the beginning, then that means God made him a liar and a murderer. How many did not believe that so? Amen? Two of you? Good. Okay, all of us hopefully believe that. So guess what? Because God is love. And how many know when you have love, you have free will? And when you have free will, you have the right to reject even a perfect loving father. And so that's what Satan did. So one day Satan said, you know what? I'm tired. He was the worship leader, it infers, in heaven. And one day he said, you know what? I'm tired of giving worship to God. I want worship. I want to be like the Most High God, which caused him to what? Jesus said in Luke 10:18 that he said, I saw Satan cast out of heaven like lightning. It was like God the Father said, okay, you want to be God? You want to do this? You want to wear the daddy pants? Then flick that ant off my picnic table. Amen? Phew, out. You know what I mean? I mean, think about how fast lightning. We've had some last week. Think how fast that was. Phew, he was gone. I mean, let me think about it. I mean, he was, nope, it's done. You've rejected me. Which caused him to go from being called Lucifer to being called Satan, the accuser. Antichrist, who is possessed by Satan, does according to, as it said, his own will. Contrast that with Jesus, who is God, who prayed what? Not my will, but your will be done, Father. Amen. How many know that's a good prayer for us to pray? If Jesus prayed that prayer, I love what Pentecost, some extreme Pentecostals say, you know, you don't say, Lord, your will be done. You say, this is what I want, God. You command the Lord. How many know that's not right? You can make requests to the Lord. You can ask the Lord. You can say, Lord, Father, if it be your will, I'd like this. And God says, let your requests be made known. But notice it does not say, make your demands known. It says, let your requests be made known to God. And how many know a request is that, a request? And that means God has the right to say, no. You know. And how many know no is an answer? It really is. People say, God doesn't answer my prayers. In fact, I ask the prayers you want, how he wants, but how many know no is not, is an answer. And how many know sometimes God's saying, how many has heard this? Wait. That's an answer too. We all love that one, don't we? You know, yeah, wait. That's why I think people say, God, speed. Speed up, God, please. Right? You know, but anyway. Middle of verse 36. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god. Again, contrast the Antichrist exalting and magnifying himself, bragging about himself, with Jesus, who is the perfect representation of God, who is God. He says, although he was God, he humbled himself and made himself of no reputation. Philippians 2:5. How many love that? If you remember when we studied Philippians, it's the kenosis, that word there. It means God dimmed it down. Jesus didn't stop being God. Some people say that. No. He was still God Almighty come in the flesh. I was talking to this Mormon guy up in Phoenix, and he was saying, we believe in Jesus. We believe, you know, they pretty much say they believe in everything we do. And I said, but no, you don't. And they said, yes, I do. I go, no, you don't. I said, here it is. Do you believe Jesus is Elohim, God Almighty come in the flesh? Oh, absolutely not. I said, but what does the Bible say? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So if Jesus is a man who became God, then that means he's sinful like you and I. So how can a sinful man die in our place? Only God could die for the sins of man, because only God is sinless. Remember Jesus said when the rich young ruler came to him and said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said, why do you call me good? Only God is good. That's why I love people when the people say, oh, why do bad things happen to good people? Because the answer is there's no such thing as good people. Now, you might be more gooder than someone else, but you ain't gooder compared to God, okay? You got sin, and if you don't, then you got really big issues called pride and blindness, right? So we all have sin, right? So anyways, that was free. There you go. That's for you, Eric. All right. Here it is. I love what one of my Bible teachers used to say about the kingdom of self. He said this, the kingdom of self is the kingdom of Satan. How many know that? We always think it's Satan's kingdom, our kingdom, and God's kingdom. How many know there's no three kingdoms? There's only God's kingdom and Satan's kingdom. And whenever you and I say, I did it my way, guess whose kingdom that is? Satan's going, you sucker, you did it really my way. Right? Because why? The kingdom of self is the kingdom of Satan. You go, well, I don't know about that. Well, that's why I have to give you every address so you know I'm not making stuff up. James 4:7 says what? Submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and what? He must flee. Don't submit to God, and what happens? The devil's going to stick around. I've had people say, Craig, I want deliverance. I want deliverance, but I want to still do my own will. And I said to them, lovely, you know, I love what one guy said who does deliverance. He says, God will not deliver you from your friends. He only delivers you from your enemies. So if you're not sure that the devil's bad and your self-will's bad, guess what? You need to be more broken to where you go, I am ready to submit to God and resist the devil. Amen? What happens if you don't submit to God and you're delivered? It says the house is swept clean. And then what happens? The spirits say, oh, man, the house is swept clean, but it's not filled and submitted to God. So what happens? They come back, and it's worse, seven times worse than it was. They'll bring seven times more evil demons will come in. And that's why it's important for us to be submitted and full of God. Amen? I don't want any Klingons on my life. Amen? I don't believe a Christian can be possessed because you're sealed of spirit. But how many know I believe Christians, there's a lot of Christians that are oppressed. Amen? And you say, oh, I don't believe in that. Calvary's don't believe in that. I'm a Calvary, but I disagree respectfully because I was delivered as a Christian from oppression. But how many know this? What is Paul say to the Ephesian Christians in Ephesians 4:27? He says, do not give in to anger, which gives what? The devil a mighty foothold. If you can't be oppressed, what is a foothold then? Sounds like a place in your life, right? I want to be, you ever seen those old lifts in a garage, the slick chrome lifts? I want to be like that. I heard someone once describe it this way. It's like a lot of times we have sin and unforgiveness in our life and we're just sinful. It's like the devil can throw his demon on us and it just sticks to us. How many want to be like that lift where you throw a cat on it and just all the way down? Right? That's who I want to be. No holds, right? No footholds. I want the cat to go, hey, you know what I mean? I don't want that. So anyways, middle of verse 36, 2. Shall speak blasphemies. Or the King James says a very interesting word. The old King James says, he shall speak blasphemies and marvelous things. It's kind of weird. Blasphemies, and then it says marvelous things. Well, there'll be blasphemies, but they'll seem marvelous to those who are deceived. People marvel over what he says. So that's what that means. They'll speak blasphemies or marvelous things against God of gods. Antichrist will speak so powerfully, so convincingly, that he'll make people marvel or mesmerized by his deceiving words. He'll speak so well that he'll make Adolf Hitler and he'll make Winston Churchill, a lot of young people don't know who that is, but that makes them look like stammers or stutterers. He'll be so deceiving that he'll inspire the whole world or a lot of the world to turn against the true and living God. And we're going to see today that he'll even turn away, he'll even get religious people who kind of playing games in the church to turn away. How many do not want to be one of those people that gets caught up in his deception? You know, and to think, oh, I would never be deceived. I love what, remember Roger Bearer? Does anyone remember Roger Bearer of Calcis? He said this, the problem with being deceived is you don't know you're deceived when you're deceived. So, you know, you need to stay close to God and stay close to his truth because it's easy to be deceived. And it'll be easy to be deceived by the Antichrist if you're not walking close to God. 2 Thessalonians 2:9, and you want to turn there? Why don't you turn there for a second? Keep your finger in Daniel, but also, I want you to see this because you need to see this. Because this is now what I'm going to kind of focus on a lot, but I want you to see this verse so that you know it's not me making it up. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9, that's in the New Testament. All right, page 904. No, I'm kidding. Just teasing. Is everyone there? Talking about the Antichrist, verse 9, he says, this man will come to do work of Satan. So he's going to be possessed by Satan. With counterfeit power and signs and miracles. I love this real quick. Hear this. How many love miracles? I do. How many love the power of God? But hear this, I love it. What did Jesus say? A wicked and adulterous generation asked for a sign. Remember they said, do a miracle, Jesus. And he said, the wicked and adulterous. So you go, well, wait, what is it? Hear this, signs and wonders, Jesus said, follow those who believe. But true believers do not follow signs and wonders. Does that make sense? So when you're looking to, ooh, give me a wonder, ooh, you're like, what was it, Herod, oh, do a miracle. You're in a wicked, adulterous generation. I heard, what's her name? The big hair girl, what's her name? Was from Texas. Beth Moore. Yeah, Beth Moore said it this way. She said, wanting signs and wonders from God is like marrying a man for his money, and you don't love him. Do Do you get it? Because you're saying, do something for me, God. Dazzle me. And how many know God has already dazzled you with the cross? And all miracles should be, you know, I want a miracle not to believe more in you. I want a miracle because I want your glory to spread. I want you to be glorified. I don't want to just, I'm not sure I believe in you. Do a miracle. That's a wicked, adulterous generation, says that. But listen, this man will come and do the work of Satan with counterfeit power and signs and miracles. Verse 10, he will use every kind of evil deception to fool those on their way to destruction. Now hear this, I'm putting this in here. Why? Ask the why. Here's the why. There's always a clause. Why? Because they refuse to love and accept the truth that would save them. Verse 11, here's where it really gets scary. Listen, put your earphones on now. So God will cause them to be greatly deceived. Did you hear who will cause them to be greatly deceived? God. Or the King James says, the old King James, send them a strong delusion. Now here again, why? And they will believe the lies. Verse 12, here's the why. Then they will be condemned. Why? For they enjoyed evil, or as the old King James said, had pleasure in unrighteousness. Hear that. They had pleasure in unrighteousness rather than believing the truth. Did you hear that? Why are they going to be handed over to a deceiving spirit of delusion, a delusioning spirit, a spirit that blinds their eyes from the truth? Because they enjoyed evil, took pleasure in evil or unrighteousness rather than believing the truth. Church, how many know that we have a lot of people delighting in unrighteousness in the church today? Yeah? Just doing stuff, saying, and then what do they say? Grace, grace, grace. Hey, grace. Grace was never meant to be a doormat for our sin. Grace was there when we sincerely seek God and we miss the mark. No one, remember what sincere means? It means the bullseye. And you had the bullseye and then you had all these rings and each one was one sincere, two sincere, three sincere off. How many know a true marksman who loves, you know, to hit, he loves his God, is not trying to shoot the barn. A true marksman is trying to shoot, or a true archer is trying to shoot the bullseye, but there's going to be times when we truly miss the will of God. Amen? That's what grace is for. It's kind of like I heard a football coach say it this way. If I said to Morgan, if he was playing football for me, I'm the coach, I say, Morgan, you're gonna do your best to catch that pass. And Morgan says, I don't know. Maybe, maybe not. You know, grace. That's going to make me frustrated. Amen? But if Morgan says, Dad, Coach, I'm going to do my very best to catch that pass, and he does his very best, and the quarterback overthrows it, and he just misses it, how many know that's grace? Because he was trying with all his heart. That's what grace is for us. It's never meant to say, hey, I don't know if I want to catch the pass today. I don't know if I want to really live for God today. And how many can humbly say that that's been the church of Jesus Christ, and at least in America a lot? We, as he said, we take pleasure in unrighteousness rather than believing the truth. And those people who live that way, it says that, I'll just say it now so I can get your mind thinking about this. How many saw the Left Behind series? Do you know this verse is contradicting? Do you remember the first one? Do you remember when everyone's raptured? And remember when they're in the church and it's the black pastor and all the people, there's like 20 people in the church. And remember they're all like, oh, it's real. We need to get right with God. Oh. What's this verse saying? Not going to happen. Because why? It says when they had the chance to believe the truth, instead they were what? Taking pleasure in unrighteousness. And because of that, God is going to hand them over to a strong delusion or to be deceived. That should put some fear in us, should it not? You're all glad you came this morning, aren't you? You're wondering why I had a hard morning. Do you see why? It's like the devil doesn't want you to know this. Yeah, go for it. Do whatever you want. Yeah, no big deal. God says it's a big deal, does he not? God says it's a big deal. And I don't know about you, but hear this. Can I just say this to you lovingly? You're left behind. There's a good chance you're going to be left behind for eternity. Amen? Because that's what this says. And hear this, that's why it's so important that we don't get our theology from movies. Amen. God bless movies. I'm not, I love this Left Behind series. But they got it wrong here. And how many know that's kind of a big important thing? But you know why they do it? Because we want everyone to think, oh, we have another chance. Oh, we have another. How many know there's going to be a day when it's depart from me? I never knew you. And hear me, guys. I know you guys think, gosh, Craig, you wonder why the church is small. I don't care about the size. I mean, I do care about the size of the church, but I don't care. I'm not going to compromise to grow the church. Amen. Amen. Because I've been called by God to present a church to him without spot or wrinkle. And I don't want any, I don't want half of you to be here when we're raptured. I want all of you to be gone. I want this church, I want people to go, hey, that place looks like there's a lot of weeds around it. What's going on? I don't want anyone here taking care of this place. I want the pagans taking over because there's no, or the, you know, whatever, the weird New Age church taking over because we ain't here. I don't want 20 of you or 10 of you in here going, what, I should have listened to him. I always hated his sermons, but doggone, I think he was right. End of verse 36. And shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. For what has been determined shall be done. The world will rally around the Antichrist. This coming world leader, this Antichrist, this great orator, this magnetic personality. But hear this, and this is encouragement, even though we're not going to be here, those of us who are in Christ, he will prosper, but only for an appointed time. How many love that about God? He'll allow evil to do his thing, but there's a time where he'll say, enough. And there's a time where he'll say, remember with Job, he said, you can do this, but you can't do this. Here's the parameters. Don't you love that? I love, just like he gives boundaries to the ocean. How many glad he gives boundaries to the ocean? Especially if you live by the ocean, you'd be glad. But, you know, we don't know what an ocean is. But, you know what I mean? Boundaries. But he gives boundaries to the enemy, and he says, you cannot go past this. And he's going to someday say enough to Satan. How many longer for that day when he's bound in the bottomless pit for all eternity? That will be a happy, happy day. Verse 37, he shall regard neither the God of his fathers. This verse is the reason that a lot of Bible teachers believe that although Antichrist is probably coming, is going to come out of Europe, he will be of Jewish heritage, because this is an idiom when it says he did not follow the God of his fathers. That's sort of saying that's inferring that he was Jewish. So a lot of scholars, I'm not a scholar, but a lot of scholars believe he's going to probably have some Jewish heritage in him. And that's so kind of look for, well, we're not going to see it, but he's going to probably be of Jewish heritage from Europe. Middle of verse 37, nor the desire of women. That's pretty wild in this PC day, isn't it? Nor desire women. Though this is very interesting to me, because some scholars also believe that the Antichrist could very well be homosexual. How many know that could fit today, could it not? Very well. Because now think about it, that we're a politically correct society wanting to do things because we just want to show how politically correct we are. How many know we need to get to a place where we vote leaders, not because of their skin color or their gender, but because of who's the best for the country? Amen? Amen. That's a weak amen, but okay, amen, amen. Thank you. You know, but how many know that? You shouldn't want to make history by having a bad leader because he's a black man or a white man or a red man or a woman or whatever, transgender. We should be saying, who is the best person for the job? Didn't Martin Luther King say? He said, hey, I want my kids to have no, don't judge them at all and let them do whatever they want. He said, I long for the day when my kids will be judged by what? Their character and not their skin color. So here's what he's saying. Judge me. Judge them, but don't judge them by their skin color. Judge them by their character. And the Bible says it, doesn't it? Even a child is known by his actions. Amen? And yet we want this get out of jail card because I have some different gender. And we got to get past that, guys. Amen? We got to get past that. We got to be colorblind as Christians and love all men. Love all women. Love, and hear this, we love the homosexual, agreed? But we love them enough to say, if you continue practicing homosexuality, you will not be saved. Because the Bible says that. Amen? And that's more loving than saying, yeah, sure, go for it. Be a homosexual Christian. Because that's an oxymoron. It goes against what the Word of God says. And I don't care what the modern day pastors say, the special Greek. How many know this word was written for common men? Now, I know Daniel doesn't seem very common because I even read it sometimes. I go, wow. Okay? But how many know the gospel was written for pretty, very common men? The New Testament's pretty clear. Amen? And we shouldn't complicate it. When you hear someone say, well, the special Greek means that you're specially weird. Stop. Right? It's, you know, I love what someone said. That if the, what is it? How I always mess it up. If the natural sense or if the basic sense makes sense, seek no other sense. Does that make sense? If the Bible, like I'll have this, extreme Calvinist. It says he died in John. It says, 1 John, he says he died for our sins and the sins of the whole world. I'm going to think that's pretty clear. Died for our sins, those who are saved, and the sins of the whole world. But they'll say, no. He died for our sins, the elect, and for the sins of the whole world, elect. I'm going, why didn't he put elect? How hard would it be for God to have John put elect in? But he didn't. But guess what? You re-wrangle. Let's stop that. Let the Bible say what it says. But hear this, just so you make sure you say, well, you said take everything just the way it is. How many know when it says in Psalms that God covers us with his feathers, that God is not a chicken? Okay? That way we have to look at it and say, okay, maybe that's a metaphor. Maybe that's a word picture. Okay? But when it says it, just clearly take it. If the basic sense makes sense, take that. But seek no other sense. But if it doesn't, you go, okay, maybe that's a word picture. Right? It says the Lamb of God. Jesus is not, he's not a lamb. Okay? Does that make sense to you guys? Okay, good. I hope it does. Okay. But think about this. We had a first black president. Now our country is flirting with having a lady president, which, you know, the Bible says the only places the women can't rule is at home and in the church. But how many know we can have a woman CEO? We can have a woman what's that, Florina guy? Girl. But we can have a woman president. There's nothing unbiblical about that. Now some people say, well, I don't like it. But, well, okay. But that we can have that. It's not unbiblical to have a woman president. But how many know we shouldn't just elect a president because she's a woman? We should get the best person. And now if it's a woman, right on. But I'm saying is we don't do it because, hey, we want to make history. Do you get my point? You hear me? Feel me, dog? All right. Hey, dog, sorry, dog. Dog's like, what? You dogging? No. Anyway. And now our first world leader will probably be a homosexual. But think about how that fits in our progressive agenda. And isn't it amazing? I love this, you know, and it's kind of like, can't we all get along? You know, can't we all kumbaya, my love? Right? But isn't it funny that the people who scream tolerance, which really, if you understand the word tolerance, what does it mean? It means I disagree with you, so therefore I have to tolerate you and give you the right to disagree with me, and you give me the right to disagree with you. But what is their definition of tolerance? They've redefined it. Tolerance means, stupid Christians, you will agree with us and that homosexuality is cool, and we're going to shut you up if you don't. Did you hear it? I think I've told you this. I think it was Alito. Is it Alito, the Supreme Court Justice? Alito? Alito, I can show it to you on my phone, but Alito said basically this, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm shredding it, but if you want to see it, I can show it to you on my phone. But he basically says, Christians that hold to a biblical worldview about homosexuality and marriage need to basically shut their yapper. He didn't say that. He said it more articulate than that. But they better shut their yapper, because if they say what the Bible says, they'll be considered archaic and bigoted. So when you got your Supreme Court justice saying that, how many know it's coming to a city near you? It's just a matter of when and a matter of how. And I'm not trying to scare you, but I am saying this. Vote for people who best represent your biblical values and believe that we can truly be tolerant and agree to disagree. Because here's what I say. Did you hear about when Caitlyn Jenner was calling up churches in Texas? Remember those churches that wouldn't give over their sermons? She called them up and she said, hi, can I come to your Bible study? And they said, and she goes, because I'm transgender, I'm going to bring a bunch of my friends. And you know what I would have said? I would have loved to have got the phone call. Mariah might have freaked out on that phone call, but how many of you, I would love that phone call. I'd say, Caitlin, would you like me and my church members to come to your transgender meeting and take it over? No, you would say that's wrong. So, Caitlin, if you want to come to hear about Jesus, you're welcome. But if you're coming to convert us, not welcome. Amen? Amen? Agree to disagree. Respect. How many know? In America, everyone has the right to be wrong. And we have to honor that. Amen? And God, I mean, God honors that. Some of you look at me scared now. You can say this in church? Yes, you can. If you want it to be small. No, I'm just kidding. verse 37. Nor regard any god, for he shall exalt himself above them all. Let me just say that back when I said we want to be small. How many know this? If Donald Trump can do as well as he's doing, and people are saying he's crazy, but I kind of like that he says what I wish I could say. How many know the church should get that way too? Now, I don't think we should say the things he says, don't get me wrong, but I'm saying we should be able to speak some things that seem crazy but are in the Word of God. Because I know you guys feel it, but you're like going, I didn't get them. Can we talk like this anymore? How many know the reason why the liberal agenda is so strong? Because we have shut up. Remember what one person said? The liberal agenda is pushing us into the closet, and they're radically coming out of the closet. But guess what? We just read in Romans, if you're reading your Bible, how will they know unless a preacher sent? If you don't speak the truth in love, who's going to? Who's going to? Hello? Nobody. And you can't curse the darkness when you don't let the light shine. And you can say, well, my witness is a silent witness. Well, we had someone here in this church who went to church for a couple years and never heard in that church that homosexuality is wrong. If he doesn't know it's wrong, how can he tell others it's wrong? And I love what one big church, I won't say the name, but it has a house of mud, okay? But hear this, that church said, someone said, I'm going back to that church. And I said, well, that church doesn't believe in homosexuality. You know what they said? But at least they're smart enough not to teach on it. And guess what? That church is now flirting with it. It's time, America, it's a time, Christians, to say enough is enough. It's time to speak the truth in love. It is. And I'll say this to you, because I'm just on a roll today, you know, is that if this church needs to get down to 10 people who really love God, God bless it. Because I'd rather have 10 people who love God than have 3,000 people that are all going to be left behind. Amen? Thank you. Someone loves me. All right. Where am I? Nor regard any god, for he shall exalt himself above them all. Antichrist will be his own god. Like Antichrist, people who are atheists or agnostics worship most silly god of all, and that is who? Themselves. An atheist or agnostic will say, I worship only that which I see and understand and comprehend. In so doing, they worship their own intellects. Hear this. I always love this. This little trivia for you. How many people have met someone who says they're agnostic? You ever met anyone that says that? Yeah. Okay, here's what you say to them. It's always fun to do. This is why I make a lot of friends. Agnostic, if you study 1 John, means to know. The Gnostics, to know, means you have special knowledge. No. Agnostic means to not know. Okay? Now, that doesn't sound too bad, but if you get agnostic in the Latin, you know what it means? Ignoramus. So I say, do you like calling yourself an ignoramus? They go, what do you mean? I go, well, that's what agnostic means in the Latin, dummy. Okay, I don't say that. No, I don't say that. But isn't that funny? I'm an ignoramus. I only believe, I don't know. But you know, I mean, it's just weird how the things we say, you might want to research a word before you say, that's what I am, you know. But anyway, did you know that the Bible says that there is no God? Did you know that? Psalms 14:1 says there's no God. How many know I'm not saying the whole verse? Right? Some of you go, hey, Satan, right? And you go, you're doing it. No, okay. No. How many know that the whole verse says this? Psalms 14:1 says the fool says in his heart, there is no God. I used to do on the radio show, I'd say the Bible says no God, and everyone would call him, what? And then I'd tell the verse, but it was kind of fun. Again, I like to cause trouble. But anyways, the word fool here, and I like this, is not someone who is slow intellectually. Because you think, that's not fair, right? If someone's like, if someone's Forrest Gump and they don't get it, you know, that's not fair. But hear this, the word fool here is someone who's willfully ignorant. Willfully ignorant. This is the person, they're willfully ignorant to God and His Word. This is the person. Have you ever witnessed to somebody where you tell them everything and they answer every question? And I love even this. I did this at the U of A before. I said, if I answer every question you have, will you come to know Jesus? No. How many know that's not a sincere seeker? The attitude of a lot of people is, don't confuse me with the facts. I've already made up my mind. How many know that's a fool? The fool has said no. Now, don't get me wrong. There are sincere seekers, amen? But there also are people who are fools who just say, no, I don't want to I don't want to believe in God. Okay? 2 Peter 3:5, to confirm this, says, they deliberately forget, or the old King James says, they are willfully or willingly ignorant. Willingly ignorant. So it's not that they're ignorant because they don't know. They won't want to know. And how many know this? That everyone's going to believe in God someday. Now I hope you and I stand before God in the Bema seat judgment, the reward judgment, to say, hey, hi. You know, we fall on our face. He picks us up. Hey, Daddy. Instead of judge. How many do not want to meet? How many know you are not going to, Judge Wapner is not going to help you at the White Throne judgment? You know? You're not going to say, well, let me get my lawyer. There is no lawyer, right? And how many know when people say, I was basically a good person, run the tape, Peter. I mean, it will be, how many would not like the tape run? Have you ever seen, you know, that with video? I see videos of myself and I say, who is that? I don't even know the guy in my body. Who is that guy? Can you imagine we saw all the things we supposedly did that was good? We've done a lot of things that we did. Could you imagine if I said, every week we're going to highlight one of you and show what you do at home, how you treat your spouse, how you treat your dog, right? We're going to show you. You would be embarrassed, would you not? You know, the heck you will. You won't do that, my boy, right? But you know, I mean, no, there's some things. You see me driving, you see video, you go, that's my pastor? Oh, my goodness, right? But don't get uppity. If I saw the way you drive, you're probably the one I get mad at. Romans 1:20 says this, for ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God has made, they can clearly see His invisible qualities, His eternal power and divine nature. So hear this, they have no excuse for not knowing God. The Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God. How many know that? You look out there. I always like to say, I'm kind of, you know, I can sometimes be cynical. I love to look up. Whenever someone says something great about creation, I'll look at the stars with people and I just go, isn't that amazing that all happened by chance? That's amazing. You know, or when someone will tell me something complex about our universe or DNA, I'll go, and it all happened just boom, nothing. You know, how many know? Did any of you have kids with dirty rooms? Take a hand grenade, throw it in there, and see how nice that room is afterwards. But that's what we believe happened to creation, that just boom, and everything's just perfect. How many know the Bible says you're fearfully and wonderfully made? People that thought, you know, I don't know if you saw, what's the show or the series, The Truth Project. But remember they said the one-celled amoeba was nothing, and now they realize it's so complicated. There's this motor that spins. Remember the motor thing that would spin around, the little hair thing? It's like this little motor in there. And they're saying that is so complicated. The thing they thought was nothing is more complicated than ever. And guess what? Even scientists who aren't even really seemingly seeking God are going, there has to be a designer. And yet, guess what happens? What's the reward for being honest? Remember, science used to be empirical evidence. You let the evidence lead you to the truth. They get fired. They don't get their tenure. They get it yanked. Because why? You don't believe what is not true. And the Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God. The Bible says that every man and woman, hear this, if you think, what about the pygmies in Africa? God will reveal Himself to the pygmies in Africa if they want truth. You know, I know that because my grandfather was a missionary in Haiti. Have you heard of Haiti? The word Haiti means hell. Their national religion was Satanism. Okay? They're a pretty rough crowd. And he would go there in these little remote villages, and guess what? He would say, he never did, I don't think, but his friend went, and they said, okay, whatever you got, we're going to believe it. And he goes, you haven't even heard it yet. He goes, yeah, but I was the witch doctor or whatever shaman was praying to shaman God, and he said he heard this vision that there's going to be a white man who comes with this black book, believe whatever he tells you. How many know God will reveal Himself to whoever wants truth? John 7:17, this is free, this isn't in here. John 7:17 says, Jesus said, to all who desire to know the truth will know whether my words are of man or of God. So believe that. Don't go, what about what? Every man and woman, God will reveal himself. Even if they don't have the word, he'll reveal it. And they'll just be judged, as it says in Romans 1, by their conscience. They'll be judged by living, doing. How many know every man knows? You know. How many know? As a pagan, I knew it was not good to beat people senseless. I knew that. You have a conscience. You know. And anyway, as we saw in 2 Thessalonians 2 again, you can go back there if you have your finger there, 2 Thessalonians 2:9. Antichrist will deceive a lot of people in the last days. And why again? Because they had a chance to really live their life for Jesus like us today, but they didn't. And yet all of us said that a lot of people in church are playing games. And I want to encourage you guys, let's not play games. Amen. I love one of my favorite verses that kind of I love and scares me at the same time is, how many know I'm not video cameraing you? That would be weird, right? But how many know God is? The Bible says in Hebrews 4:13 that everything we do, everything is laid bare before the eyes of the Lord to whom we must give an account. Everything you do. So hear this. I love what people say. Integrity is doing the right thing when nobody's watching. Guess what the truth is? Somebody's always watching, and his name is God Almighty. And so we should fear God. And we should say, God, I don't want to do anything that's going to be on the tape that hurts or grieves you. Amen? 2 Thessalonians 2:12 says this again. They will be condemned for enjoying evil or had pleasure in unrighteousness rather than believing the truth. I believe, church, we're in the last days. We all say it, but we don't live as if we really are in the last days. If we believe we're in the last days, then how many know this is the time to, you know, start bulk? How many know this? What do girls do? Oh, it's summer, bikini season, time to get ready, right? How many know it's bikini season? Or swimsuit, maybe we don't wear bikinis, right? We're Christian. It's swim gear season, right? You know, right? But how many know if we get ready for that, we should get ready for the Lord's return? And we should be serious. Not that we shouldn't be serious even if the Lord is going to come if we knew 20 years, but we should get serious because we see it. Do we not see the times? If the Lord doesn't come back for another 20 years, then take me out of here. Amen? Because my goodness, if you're happy to be here, maybe you need to get saved because I am not happy to be here. You know what I mean? I'm not saying I don't love his creation, but I'm saying, my goodness, this world is going cuckoo, is it not? I mean, we don't have to get into it right now, but you talk to me afterwards. I'll tell you some things. As I said, I love the Left Behind series, but I believe they missed it big time when they showed that they would have this second chance and that they would just be able to go, hell, we get it now. How many know a lot of people would like to do that? A lot of people would like to. I've had people say, I want to go through the tribulation because it will really test my faith. That's not the right attitude. I think that's why Jesus said this in Revelation 3:16. He said, I wish you were either hot or cold, but since you are lukewarm, I'll spit you out. Do you notice your Lord is kind of an extremist? Do you notice Jesus said, you're either for me or against me? You either sow with me or you scatter. You're either on or off. You're not sorta, right? And yet, I've told you, right? I said to you, how many are hot for Jesus? One person raised their hand. And then I said, how many are cold? I told you, one man, my wife made me come. I hate this place, right? But most people say, you're not too hot, you're not too cold, you're just right. You're like the little bear's porridge. How many of you? And everyone goes, ugh! How many know that condemns us? We need to be hot. You should be hotter today than you were. You know, I was hotter. I had to say today in worship with tears, restored to me the joy of myself. I had to say, God, I loved you more 34 years ago than I do today sometimes. Can anyone else say that? I love Keith Green said, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold. I know I ought to be alive to you and dead to me. What can be done with an old heart like mine? Right? And I had to be humble to say, God, You know, how many know ministry can be a little rough? Look at my hair, okay? But hear this. I still have to not let my heart get hardened and frustrated. I still have to be tender towards God. Amen? You know why they say most pastors commit adultery and freak out? Because they're angry. They're angry at God, and they're angry how the church treats them, and they say, I deserve this. Isn't that sad? I don't want to be like that. I'm not saying I am. What is Pastor Craig saying? I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I don't want to be angry. I want my heart to be tender before God. But here's the point. Back to the point. We need to be moving towards being hotter today than we were 20 years ago. Because guess what? What does it say in the last days? What's part of it? And can we be real here? It says sin will abound and men's hearts will wax cold. Anyone here been tempted to have a cold heart? Everyone here, we all love people, right? We love people. We just can't wait to be around people. Why do you think people love to watch church on TV? Because it's like, what do people say? I love you, God. I just hate your people. Ever said that? I have. But guess what? You know what God says? Just like I loved you when you were a jerk. He didn't say that. I want you to love people that aren't easy to love too. Hear this, guys. You cannot love God without loving his church. God loves his church. He does. And he'll admit, it's messed up. But he loves his church. And so we need to too. So guess what, church? The Antichrist is coming. That's good news, isn't it? Okay. The Antichrist is coming, but guess what? Maybe someone is playing games with God. You do not want to meet the Antichrist. Amen? Amen? Because if you meet the Antichrist in the tribulation period, you will 99%, 98% chance you will be swept away and deceived by him. Because you had the chance to hear the truth today. That's why the Bible tells us, I'm going to read to you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 verses. Hear them. I'll read them in succession. 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, today is the day of salvation. Sounds like God wants you to get saved today, right? Because guess what? You're not guaranteed tomorrow. What if you say this? You know what, God? I think what Pastor Craig said was right, and I really want to serve you, but there's some things I want to do. Wickedness. Remember he says they want to get, what are they given to? They're given to, what was it? They're given to, I can't think right now. Pleasure, unrighteous pleasure. There's some unrighteous pleasure I still want to do. What if the Lord comes back tonight? Amen? We need to say today is the day of salvation. Ecclesiastes 12:1 says this, remember now your Creator in the days of your youth before the difficult days come. Do you hear that? Can I Craigonize that for you? It's saying don't wait till you're older to seek God. Seek God now because guess what? There's a day coming when it's going to be too late. My grandpa actually told me, he says, Craig, you're young. Don't waste your life on Jesus. When you're older and you have nothing to live for, then seek God. I love one person said, a comedian said, you know why a lot of old people really love and study the Word of God? He says, because it's like they're cramming for a test. How many know we should be cramming for the test today? Because guess what? We don't know if the Lord's going to come back tonight. It doesn't matter if you're old, young, or he's coming back. You know what I mean? And I hope we all meet him in rapture instead of death. Amen? Psalms 32:6. Therefore, let the godly pray to you, God, while there is still time, that they may not drown in the floodwaters of judgment. Doesn't that sound like us today? How many know judgment's going to come to America if America doesn't turn? And we should pray now when it's not too crazy, because guess what? Look at Daniel who we're studying. Daniel went through judgment even though he was a righteous man. He was made into a eunuch. I don't think he wanted to do that. Made into a eunuch and served Babylonian kings for 70 years. How many know that God will provide for you? He provided Daniel, he exalted Daniel. But how many know he still had to suffer with those who had rejected God and did not obey him? So guess what that means? While there's time, we should be interceding and crying out. Remember I told you, we all say it's the last days. We all say that we need revival, but guess what? The one thing we're lacking still a lot. Can we be humble? Prayer. Amen? Amen. I will take your silences
This is getting really convicting.
Or I'm a jerk. What is it? No, okay. Matthew 24:44. Jesus said, "You also must be ready all the time, for the Son of Man will come when least expected." So when you say, "Oh, I got time," you know, he's going to come. So guess what? Remember the 10 virgins? 5 had their oil ready, were filled. That means filled with the Spirit, ready, living on fire for God. 5 weren't. But what did they say? "Oh, give me some oil. Give me some oil. The bride's coming. Give me some." And they said, "No, we only have enough for ourselves. Sorry." How many know you can't give the Holy Spirit? Parents, you can't give the Holy Spirit to your kids. You can only example and pray. But guess what they need to find? Young people, you need to love God for yourself. Amen? So be ready all the time. Joshua 24:15. "But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods of your ancestors, that ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites whose land you live in now?" Hear this. He's basically saying, you got to choose a god. And it's not the god of self. It's either the god of the Amorites, it's either some demonic deity, or it's me. Who is it? And hear this. I love what Joshua says. We all love this, don't we? "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." You like that? And guess what I'm saying? As the papa bear of this house, right? The human point man. "As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And even if it ain't popular, we're going to serve the Lord." I was just reading today, God was kind of trying to encourage me. And not kind of, but he was. And the verse 2 Timothy 4:2, he gave me, "Preach Christ in and out of season." Does anyone know J. Vernon McGee? He's like, beloved. So he goes like this. He died in 1988, but he said back in like 85, he said, "You know, we're living in those days where the word of God is not in season." How many know, back when I got saved in 81, and in, I would say at Grace Chapel in this town, I was still in the Jesus movement, and it was still rocking at 89. So if he was saying in 85 was out of season, then we are beyond, we're like that milk with chunks in it, out of date. You know what I mean? My goodness. You know what I mean? I mean, like I say, seriously, come on, guys. You know, you don't go to the movie Titanic, a 3-hour movie, and go, "Oh, I want my money back. That was 3 stinking hours." But if I go an hour, you guys, Craig, what's the deal? I mean, the Word of God, everyone knows we're doing half hour now. You know, isn't that funny? Calvary's used to dog it. Oh, sermonettes for Christianettes. Oh, you know, they used to say, "We do 45 an hour." Guess what? Calvary's are doing a half hour now. Yeah. So I tell you, you got to look at this positive. Spin it positively. I give you 2 sermons for the price of 1. That's why some of you go, "I come twice a month." There you go. I get it. Perfect. And then back to 2 Corinthians 6:2, and we're done. And this New Living says, "Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation." Joshua said, "Choose this day who you will serve." Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Can someone get the lights, please? With every head bowed and every eye closed, out of respect for the Lord, I want to call you. There's some of you here today that maybe aren't saved. And what I mean by that is you would say, "You know, Craig, if I died, I'm not sure that I would go to heaven." How many know that today you can leave this place knowing that you know that you know that you're saved? The Bible says in Romans that His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. And if you're here today and you're not sure you're saved, you say, "I hope I am," then today you need to pray a prayer with me and mean it with all your heart, and God will save you. Amen? Romans 10 says, "Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord," that means whoever, "whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved." And because, hear this, guys, not one of you I want to go through the tribulation. Amen? And then there's a bigger group. There's those of you who say, "Craig, I'm pretty sure I'm saved." But if you're honest, you would say, "Craig, I've been seeking pleasure in unrighteousness. I've been playing games with God. I've been doing things I know I shouldn't. And if the Lord was to return or rapture us right now, I'd be a little bit freaked out standing before him. You heard Jesus say, always be ready. Always be ready for his return. And I really believe strongly today that I want to give you an opportunity. Those of you need to know that you're saved. And those of you who would say, I'm pretty sure I'm saved, but you need to be right with God. You need to be recommit your life to God, to say, God, I'm going to be serious. I'm not messing around anymore. This is the last days. And I want to ask you this with every head bowed and every eye closed. I would like to ask you this and hear this. I know it freaks people out, but hear this. I was at a Lutheran church, a very liberal Lutheran church, and this pastor got on me and he says, Craig, why do you always lead kids to Christ? He says, our kids came to know Jesus when they were baptized as an infant. And he goes, I don't even know what that is. What do you do? And I said to him, hey, do you want me to show you what I do? And I had him, I said, pray after me. And I had him pray the prayer. And guess what he told me a year later? He said he came to know Christ. After 22 years of ministry, he came to know Christ by praying that prayer. How many know that's cool? So if you're here today, will you do this for me? Because you say, well, I know I'm saved. I'm not going to pray a prayer to receive Christ. But hear this. How many know it's good to pray this prayer because it can't hurt you? But if you're not saved and you think, hey, you know, I am, maybe that prayer would save you. But hear this also, if you pray this prayer, it also helps you to lead other people to Christ. Amen? It helps you to be able to pray the prayer with other people when they say, hey, I'd like to accept Jesus. You don't have to bring them to me. You can pray the prayer. So would everyone out of respect for the Lord, just pray, repeat after me, everyone out loud. Just pray this prayer so no one feels like they're the only one praying it. Just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I confess to you that I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sin. And cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Thank you for saving me the first time. Or thank you for receiving me back. I give you my whole heart. I give you my life. And I say, your will be done. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. And empower me to live for you all the days of my life. That I will be ready for your return. Because I walk in the truth and not in ungodly pleasure. In Jesus' name. Amen. With every head bowed and every eye closed still, I want to ask this. We don't do an altar call here, but hear this. Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven when he comes in glory with all his heavenly angels. If you prayed that prayer to receive Christ, or you prayed that prayer with all your heart saying, God, I want to really live for you. I want to be hot for you. And you meant it. You've already prayed to God, amen, but now I'd like you before one man, every head bowed, every eye closed out of respect. But if you meant that prayer, if you said, Pastor Craig, I meant that, and I've prayed it to God, but now before one man, Pastor Craig, I'm going to raise my hand and say, I prayed that prayer and I meant it. If you prayed that prayer and meant it, just lift your hand right now. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. A lot of hands. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap for that. Bless you, God. I want to pray for you, and then we'll be dismissed to sing a song. Why don't you stand with me while we pray? Lord, I thank you for this message. And I know it was a hard message, and I know it's an intense message, but Lord, sometimes the truth hurts. But Lord, I pray that it would be godly sorrow, not worldly sorrow that leads to death and condemnation, but it would be godly sorrow that leads us to repentance. Amen. Lead us to repentance, that we are ready, that we're not just holding on by our fingernails, but we are ready because we're living for you. We're saying, God, I don't want to be halfway. I don't want to be lukewarm. I want to be on fire. So, Lord, I pray for everyone who raised their hands, and I pray for even those who didn't raise their hands, that should have. Bless them, Lord. May your Holy Spirit just continue to woo them, captivate them, to where you'll say to them, if you believe it's the last days, like you say, then it's time to live for me. It's time to be white hot for me. It's time to be radical for me. And I pray that you would loose in our church a zeal with knowledge, a passion, a love, an on-fireness to where we hate sin and love righteousness. We love. We're not self-righteous, but we love to be right with you. We love to hit the mark of your will, Lord. And so God, bless your people, Lord. Bless them. Let this not be an emotional thing. Oh, I raise my hand and feel good, and then I'll go right back. Lord, let there be a transformation to where their lives are different from this day forward, to where this church would fulfill, as we said, the vision, or the mission, I don't know what it is. But Lord, they would fulfill the Matthew 5:16, that they would allow you, your light, to shine through them so brightly that men and women and all throughout this community would see your light through them and glorify their Father in heaven, would say, I want what you have. I want the light of Jesus. I want the love that I see flowing through you. Lord, let us protect every heart in this room and who will listen on CD, or tape, or on what a line. Lord, protect every heart from getting calloused and hard by this world. Lord, this world is so easily will harden us, so easily will make us cynical. But Lord, let us stay close to you, who will keep our hearts tender and will help guard our heart with all diligence. Bless and protect your people's hearts, that they can be in this sinful world, but not of it, not caught up in the cynicism, the hopelessness, the anger, the frustration. But they know that their God is in control, and Satan will only be able to do this for a short time, and it'll be over. Let us rest in that. Amen, church? Bless your people. Let's worship the Lord.